Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I just thought I'd make a quick video this morning. You know, I just wanted to tell you, this is kind of a personal thing, that the Lord can talk to us anytime He wants to. He can get a hold of us. You know, He even dealt with even people that aren't even Christians, like Nebuchadnezzar. He used him for His glory. He used King Cyrus. He used all these people for His glory, and of course, His children. He can speak to us particularly, and those of us who are trying to walk with Him, you know, more and more, we can hear from Him and discern His voice. You know, as Jesus said, "My sheep know My voice, and they answer not to another." So, of course, I already know these things. I've been seeking the Lord about where I'm going to go and what about the ministry. As I've said from the beginning, since I first came here to the States, and even the last year too, and even since I started my ministry, brothers and sisters, my ministry that God gave me is about revival, you know, and that's what the book that the Lord gave me to write. The thing is it's called Final Boarding Call, Satan's Plan for the Ages, and Our Last Mission. So Final Boarding Call before the rapture, you know, before the tribulation begins. And then Satan's Plan for the Ages, of course, this is a plan to get people to go to hell, to fight, you know, in his job. Satan is trying to stop the seed of the woman, trying to stop the Messiah he did before. He tried to stop, you know, the nation of Israel. He tried to stop all of God's children. He tried to stop Jesus from fulfilling his work and tempting him as he did in the wilderness. And then, you know, the culmination or the capstone of Satan's work, that all-seeing eye on top of the pyramid on the back of the dollar bill, the height of Satan's work will be the Antichrist and the New World Order. And that's Satan's, you know, that's his whole purpose of going forward, is to try to, you know, stop people from bringing glory to God, to insult God. And he does that by using people as a pawn to try to be slap God in the face and, you know, tell God, like he told God about Job, you know. Oh, Job is only, you know, good because you blessed him. You know, just stop blessing him. Take away your hedge of protection from him and let me get a hold of him, you know. Let me touch Job and curse him and hurt him, and then he'll curse you to your face. That's what Satan said to God about Job. So that's what Satan tries to do, brothers and sisters. He tries to discredit God, you know, and then we are only pawns to him in that process. So if you can get that perspective and get that truth, then when you see things happening, you can get it in the greater picture that Satan is don't even care about you. He wants to destroy you because he wants to hurt God. And then God does love us and cares about us, even at the most smallest level, brothers and sisters, even at the most minute level. Now, the Lord has shown me lots of things about the church, about revival, about the tribulation, about the rise of the New World Order, all those things. And then there's been times in the past where the Lord is talking to me about personal things. As an example, like in 2003, 2004, one time I was getting ready to take a bath, and the Lord was just telling me out of the blue, you know, there's a tick on the back of your head. And I was like, that can't be the Lord. What would the Lord be talking to me about something like that? That's crazy. And then I felt around, and then there it was. There was a tick. You know, and the Lord spoke to me about something so small. So, you know, just a little thing that's not related to the Bible, not related to doing something for him, and not related to, you know, me doing that I need to repent, or I need to read this in the Bible, or do this, or do that. It was a personal thing. So, you know, praise the Lord. So, anyway, the last 24 hours, I mean, the Lord has been, you know, because I've been seeking the Lord about whether I should go to Little Rock, and I thought, you know, to Arkansas, and I thought the Lord had told me to go there. But some of you guys hear from the Lord a lot, and you know what I mean. Lots of you guys don't, and you don't know what I'm, you know, because you didn't have the experience with it. But it's like this. You know, there's all these different levels of the Lord talking to you. He can quicken your spirit about a Bible verse, or you can be reading the Bible, then the Bible verse keeps coming into your head, or a Christian song. Sometimes even the lyrics from a worldly song, but the lyrics, there's something in the lyrics that the Lord wants you to hear, a word, you know, that's what God's trying to get across to you. Sometimes you can have a dream. You can have a vision. You can have a, you know, you can be called up to heaven. Some people have been called up, like Paul, you know, to the third heaven. You can have all kinds of experiences. You know, there's people said they died. When they died, they said they went to heaven or hell and came back and all that. You know, some of those stories I don't necessarily know are true or not true. Some of them are, some of them aren't. And we can just judge that based on the Word of God. Lots of people try to use discernment, and God didn't give them the gift of discernment of spirits. you know, only a few people have that. So the way we judge these things is by the Word of God. Primary source. And then those 1% of Christians or 10% of Christians who have the gifting of discernment of spirits, then they can discern it. But, I mean, lots of people say they have discernment when it's really just a critical spirit that they have. An immature critical spirit when they're judging other people. Because our judge is not our feelings, except for by the supernatural gift of discernment of spirits, as I'm saying. But our discernment is by the Word of God. This is God's truth, and this is what this person is saying. Do they match? As a matter of fact, the Bible says, let the elders judge. If someone gives a prophecy in the church, let the elders judge. So that tells you that, you know, when I'm talking about immature spirits, you know, not everyone is an elder. And then so when a lot of times when people are being, thinking they're, you know, they have discernment and they're judging, you know, I can mention any preacher's name. And I've done this as a test before, just to test and show that it's true. I can mention any preacher's name, and there'll be people who will comment and saying they have some discernment that this person is evil. Not based on the Word of God, not that the person got up and preached against the Word of God, but it's their feelings. Or they will endorse the person because they like them. Not based again on what they said, but just their feelings about it. So when we are going to judge something, someone has a prophecy, a dream, a vision, or any preaching or whatever, they're talking about the Lord and preaching and all that, then it's judged by the Word of God. And it's supposed to be judged by the elders, not by some guy got saved last year and now they're the next, you know, they're the next pope, or they're the next, you know, they think they're the chief rabbi of Israel and they got saved last year and they're a redneck from wherever, you know, from Georgia, and the next thing you know, that, you know, they're the chief rabbi in Israel, you know. When I was in Germany, when we would used to do, do like a redneck accent version of speaking German, and some of the words we said I can't say, but Donkeschein is the German, and then we would say it as donkey something else, and then do it with like a redneck accent, because, you know, it's funny when people, you know, are day one, they're suddenly an expert, and that's what, you know, that's one of the things that we deal with here in the ministry. Is those type of situations. But anyway, brothers and sisters, just to keep it positive here, the things that the Lord's been showing me the last 24 hours are these personal things on a small scale, but it shows you that God can do anything. And let me share these with you, and I think they'll be a blessing to you. And lots of you guys have stories like this also. And those of you who don't, you can have stories like this. You know, as you try to fellowship with the Lord and walk with the Lord, you will have these experiences. So what happened is, an example, yesterday, we've had lots of rainy days here, but yesterday it was actually 83 degrees, and I've been trying to take my son, you know, out, because I spend lots of time studying and praying and all that, and, you know, and ministering to people. You know, I have dozens of people that by the grace of God, I try to minister to every day, and I ask you guys to pray too. I have people, you know, that God will give me the wisdom and the anointing to help all of them. I have, like, three people now emailing me in the last week who were talking about killing themselves, and lots of other things. I mean, it's just all those things that you do as a pastor, you know, and that's why it's sometimes frustrating when people want to major in the minors and be so judgmental of other people who are Christians, even though they might not believe in the rapture, or they do believe in the rapture and they don't believe in the rapture, and then people are hypocritical, calling them false prophets and all this. And then there's people who are messaging me today who said they're talking about killing themselves, and then someone is messaging me, you know, concerned because any Christian's name I mentioned, they want to hate on them because they don't agree with all their doctrines, you know. And note, you know, that's why Jesus said, if two of you are touching anything or in agreement, you know, then it'll be bound on earth and be bound in heaven. And so that's the whole thing. It's almost impossible to get two people to agree on everything. And there's lots of people that love to disagree. And they love to be contentious. And it's like a hobby or like their life's mission. God didn't call us to be contentious. And revival comes from unity among the brethren. God loves unity among the brethren. And this is the motto that the Lord gave me, and I've been using it since I started my YouTube channel, from the Moravians. And, you know, when I mentioned that before, someone sent me something bad about the Moravians. I mean, get a life. No one is perfect, only Jesus. You're never going to find anyone who's got perfect doctrines. I don't know. I don't endorse or discredit or agree with every doctrine they have. But the Moravians' gift from God was love. They had a 150-year-long prayer meeting and revival, and they had a Pentecostal experience. And then they believed that Israel would come back as a nation. They prayed for every night for over 150 years that Israel would return as a nation, so the Lord would return. And, you know, it happened. So anyway, the Moravians' motto is, in essentials, unity, non-essentials, diversity, and in all things, love. Dealing with other Christians. Now, the problem is, lots of you guys, because of your immaturity, and you don't know the Word of God, and you just got saved last month, you don't know that the fact that the rapture is not an essential doctrine. I believe in the rapture, a pre-tribulation rapture, 100%. I believe the Bible clearly teaches that. But it is not required to be saved to believe in the rapture, as an example. It is not required to believe in once saved, always saved, or not believe in once, always saved, to be saved. People that truly love the Lord will seek after the Lord, seek to please the Lord, seek to bear fruit of the Lord, and fruit of the Spirit, and all those things, whether they believe that they can lose their salvation or not. People that are not truly saved, they will be like a lawyer. They'll be looking for those loopholes. They'll be looking for those ways that they can do what they want to do and still go to heaven. And that's the danger of the doctrine of once saved, always saved. But there's lots of people who believe in once saved, always saved that don't live in sin. They love the Lord and they want to please the Lord. And that's what it's all about. That's why it's the priority of the essentials and seeking after the Lord and having unity among the brethren. That's what the Lord wants us to have. The seven things that God hates, people talk about the deadly sins. One of them is feet that are quick to spread mischief and disunity among the brethren. And that's why the secret to revival, besides repentance, and that's one of them. I need to do a whole series on this thing. And one of them is Psalm 127. I used to quote 127 and 133 all the time. I always get those two mixed up. So 127 and 133. One of them says, because I've quoted them so many times, I've got them mixed up now. But it says, how good and pleasant it is when brethren dwell together in unity. It is like the oil that runs down, even from Aaron's beard down to the end of his garment. You know, the Lord showed me, I believe that's Psalm 133. The Lord has shown me in that text that, you know, it's the anointing from the head, from Christ. He's our high priest. The anointing, the Holy Spirit, the oil running down from the beard of Aaron, the high priest, Jesus is our high priest, down to the garments, over the body. So unity in leadership, unity among the elders, brings unity into the body, brings revival, brings the pleasing of the Holy Spirit, not grieving the Holy Spirit. And that's what we've got, brothers and sisters. People are grieving the Holy Spirit, always being contentious, always looking for the negative. When Paul said, you know, think on these things, whatever so is good, whatever things are lovely. I can't quote the whole thing. He said, you know, think on the positive, accentuate the positive, like the old song, you know, from World War II, whatever time frame, accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative. You know, don't mess with Mr. In Between. That's an old song. But, you know, we gotta think on things that are good. Now, I'm not talking about hugging trees and being in Chrislam and all that. Of course, you have to have balance, okay? We know that. We know that there's Chrislam. We know that there's, you know, ecumenicalism, where you're uniting all these other denominations, like, you know, hooking up with the Jehovah's Witnesses or whatnot. That's out of bounds of what we're talking about here. We're talking about people who are born-again Christians uniting, you know. So anyway, brothers and sisters, as an example, go into it. Let's look at the things that the Lord has been showing me, just as I said I would talk about. Yesterday, we went to the beach, and because I've been, you know, like I said, I've been busy studying all the time, and I've got my three-year-old son, and, you know, especially since Joshua died, I always try to make an effort at least once a week that, you know, I'm going to spend lots of time with my son. So anyway, I took my son down to the beach, and we went down there, my wife too, helped me watch him, and we were there, and then it was coming to high tide. And since I was a kid, brothers and sisters, we used to go to the beach every summer down here in the North Carolina, South Carolina coast. You can find shark's teeth. And when I was a kid, we used to find shark's teeth as the tide was going out, and it's been a hobby. I've been doing it since I was a kid whenever I go to the beach. Now, I have never found a shark's tooth in the Philippines on the beach. And I've talked to people, they never found any in California on the West Coast. I've only, you know, found them and only looked for them on the here in the East Coast, South Carolina and North Carolina beaches. So anyway, I was there. And as a matter of fact, last week when we went, it was going out to low tide, and I found two or three shark's teeth. Just last week. So yesterday we were there and the tide was coming in. I always try to go to the beach when the tide's going out so I can look for shark's teeth while I'm at the beach. I always do that. It's just a hobby. And so we were there and I was sitting on the beach because my son was getting tired out. They were taking him and my wife were drinking some drink and eating a snack. And I was down there at the water and I was talking to the Lord about going to, you know, Lord, I know I've been asking you for months about where I'm going to, you know, make a permanent residence, you know, have a home base and I can go out and do the revivals. And I know you're going to send me and, I'm just waiting on you and about the rapture and all those things. And, you know, talking to the Lord and I know, you know, you can speak to me clearly and I'm just waiting on you and to hear from you. And I know for whatever reason you're not telling me the details of all these things. And then the Lord just said to me, he said, you know, I can do all things. I can talk to you anytime I want. I can get a hold of you anytime I want. I can do all things. He said, as a matter of fact, and I was like, yo, I know you can, Lord. And the Lord was speaking to my heart and saying, you know, inside my, you know, just for those who might be watching who are mockers, you know, the Lord speaks into our heart. He said, my sheep know my voice and the answer not to another. And then Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would not speak of himself, but he would speak of, you know, those things about the Lord, about Jesus. So the Holy Spirit speaks. Usually not audibly, but he can. Or an angel can speak to you audibly if God wants to do that also. But anyway, so I was sitting there, and the Lord is telling me this, and then he said, as a matter of fact, I can make a shark's tooth come to you. You know, because I'd been thinking earlier about how it's high tide, and I can't look for shark's teeth, so I'll sit down here and talk to the Lord. You know, let me add that part. So while I was sitting there, the Lord said, I can make a shark's tooth come to you. And I said, I know you can, Lord, you can do anything. And the Lord said, I'm going to make a shark's tooth come to you. He said it like three different times, and I was like, well, praise the Lord. And I was just talking to the Lord. And like a minute later, a wave came up, because I was sitting at the edge where you sit in the waves, because it was hot. It was 83 degrees, and the waves were coming up, and I was just sitting there in the waves in the shallow water. And then, boom, here comes a shark tooth come up and landed right beside me, brothers and sisters, 1 inch from my leg. And, you know, you don't ever see anything like that. I've never seen anything like that in my life, especially that it would, you know, be, you know, I guess they're like down under the sand. I guess they get up there during a storm or whatever, or, you know, they dredge the ocean in the wintertime too and blow sand up on these beaches a lot of times too in some places, and they do that down here, but they haven't done that yet. But anyway, here comes this shark's tooth landing right beside me, brothers and sisters. So, you know, it was, the Lord had just spoke to me about that, something personal, nothing to do with what I was talking to him about. So in other words, the Lord is saying, rest assured that, you know, if I want to tell you to go to Arkansas, I'll tell you clearly, it won't be questionable. You know, you'll know to go to Arkansas, or you'll know this, you know, to go to here and do this and do that and the other. So I was like, praise the Lord. You know, praise the Lord. It's awesome. And, you know, I talked to a couple of brothers last night and told them about it, you know, and just praising the Lord about it. Because, you know, he's done things like that before, but it's been a while, something personal like that. Or, you know, I usually don't tell these things. You know, I have lots of experiences with the Lord. I just don't say anything. Because I've tried to, you know, make videos of preaching. So anyway, this morning, brothers and sisters, the Lord woke me up. And what I saw, I had a night vision. And I saw this, like a woman's head, and she had this bright red hair, curly red hair. And then I saw a piece of that hair pulled loose, this red curly hair, and then it went flying, and it hit a door. It went through a door, and then the doorway turned red. The doorway turned, like the post of the door turned the same color as her hair. So I said, you know, red, you know, like the red horse, you know, is like war or something. I was like, well, this must be something to do with war. And then the Lord told me to get the phone. So I got the phone, and there was an Amber Alert on there, an Amber Alert, you know, with a light, you know, and I haven't been in the States since they've started that Amber Alert stuff too much. And, you know, this is the first Amber Alert I've ever got on my phone. I never even thought about it. Picked up the phone, boom, there's an Amber Alert. So Amber is red. You know, and that's what the Lord was showing me, something I would never even think about out of the blue. You know, here's this Amber Alert that the Lord is showing me. Okay, and that hair was pulled loose from the hair and went right through the door and it was gone. And then the door turned red. So, you know, as far as, you know, if the Lord wants to use me to help be involved in that Amber Alert, he will. He didn't tell me anything else about it. I believe he was showing me that he can get a hold of me. And as a matter of fact, let me add this too, now that I mentioned that one. That was a new one just this morning. But yesterday morning, I had my phone, again, the phone was turned off. I had the ringer turned off. I turn off the ringer at night when I go to bed. There's one brother that likes to call me at 7 o'clock in the morning. So, anyway, the Lord told me to get the phone yesterday, about the same time. I got the phone yesterday, and Brother Brian, that's OT for Jesus, he had called me yesterday, and the Lord had spoken to him, saying that if we, the church, would come together and unite, God would give us another chance. We come together and unite and pray against this Ebola, you know, and stand against it, that God would give the United States another chance. Of course, it would lead to bringing revival. And I told him, he asked me, you know, about it. And I said, yeah, brother, that sounds great. You should post it. You know, but in my heart, I believe that, and as the Lord has told me, America will not repent. But now, when I said that before, people, someone, you know, there's, you know, a thought that I was saying that, you know, that there wouldn't be revival. No, I'm not saying there won't be revival among God's people. America as a nation won't repent. It's two different things. Those who will repent, those who will be saved will be saved. Those who are going in the rapture are going in the rapture. And those who are not are not. Those who won't repent will not repent. So God is going to revive his people. And I believe that this word from the Lord is real. Just like, you know, Jonah told Nineveh to repent, and they did, and then God blessed the place. But in the case of the United States, I don't think they're going to repent. I could be wrong, but I feel, and I feel from the Lord that the Lord had impressed upon me that America will not repent. I'll say that. I don't think so, but anything's possible with the Lord. But I believe it's too late for America. In my mind, my opinion, and my feelings, it's too late for the America, unless the Lord would really, as that same text says that I quoted from about how beautiful and pleasant it is when brethren dwell together in unity. The other one, Psalm 127, said, the other Psalm, Psalm 127, that I always put those two together, says, except the Lord build the house, those that labor in vain. You know, and that's what it is. The American church has done it without God. They've done lots of things without God, and they've labored in vain. Brothers and sisters, it is a facade, you know, like a Hollywood movie set, which would be very ironic for the United States, to be the American church to be compared to Hollywood. It's all a facade. It's all smoke and mirrors, just like everything the devil does and man. It's not of God. So I believe that God's people will be revived. I believe we will see a revival on God's people, that we will be that bride without spot or blemish. The Lord will prepare us to be a bride without spot or blemish. And we're going to be out of here, brothers and sisters. And everybody else, you know, hey, all we can do is tell them. And that's why I told Brother Brian, hey, great, make that video. Because God told him to. And then it's a witness against those who will not heed the call to repent and the call to come to the Lord, those lukewarm, backslidden Christians. So yeah, even though I believe they won't respond, but we still put out the message. That's where people get confused, you know. We obey the Lord and do what he says, and God is in control and in charge and judging all these people. We're not called to judge all those people today. There's a difference between being judgmental and being discerning. And there's lots of judgmentalness and not discernment. I could say, I thought about doing it on this video. I'm not going to do it. I could rattle through a list of names of preachers, and 90% of what people's going to say is not because this person said this, which is antichrist, or this person said this, which is against the Bible. As an example, there's a preacher who says you can take the mark and still be saved and still go to heaven. The same preacher says all speaking in tongues today is from the devil. Now, those two things is telling me this preacher is very ignorant, is very pharisaical. And if he's saved, you know, it's only by the grace of God. I personally don't think that the guy's even born again. How can you know Jesus without knowing the Holy Spirit? But that's up to the Lord to decide. But those are doctrinal, biblical issues you can discuss. But other people, all the other preachers I name, you start getting into all of this, just your feelings and the way they talk is mean or too nice or whatever people think. Nonsense. Nonsense. That's judging by the flesh. And not, as Jesus said, don't judge according to these things, but judge righteously, according to the Word of God. God bless you guys. I'm going to go. And hey, you know, we're almost out of here. You know, the last few weeks when I've been making videos too, I keep seeing stuff while I'm praying or while I'm making a video. And I usually don't say anything, you know, but I'll just say that while I was making this video, I saw, when I was telling you guys about the Amber Alert, I kept seeing an angel blowing a trumpet. So praise God, brothers and sisters. I don't want to give anybody any, you know, you know, because no man knows the day or the hour of the rapture. We don't know. You know, so my feeling is the rapture won't be for a few more years. That's my personal feeling. I could be totally wrong. No man knows. So you can't say, oh, the rapture is going to be this Rosh Hashanah, this Feast of Trumpets. And then you can't say it won't be, because we don't know. We don't know. So it could be tomorrow. It could be 5 years from now. We do not know. No man knows the day or the hour. No man knows. God bless you guys. As long as you keep that in mind and don't be disheartened. People who have staked their life and, you know, their whole YouTube persona is around the Feast of Trumpets. It's just, you know, one thing. We're not called to, you know, of course, I would like to know when the rapture is, okay? We're not called to know that. We are called to know Jesus and Him crucified and to walk with the Lord and walk with Him in the cool of the day and fellowship with Him every day. and then the blessing and benefit of fellowshipping him and walking with him every day, you know, just like Enoch. Why was Enoch raptured? Because he walked with God and he was no more. So you got to walk with God and then you'll be no more. You'll be raptured. But we don't walk with God to be raptured. We walk with God to walk with God. We want to fellowship with the Lord now and forever and eternity. That's what it's all about. Our personal walk with the Lord. And that's the message, really, what the Lord's showing me. That's the summation of this last 25 minutes. It's all about your personal walk with the Lord. He just wants to walk with us in the cool of the day. End of discussion. And for not to us running to and fro trying to figure out the rapture, running to and fro and judging and attacking, as the Bible says, who are you to judge another man's servant? We're not to judge God's servants. But now if someone gives a false doctrine that's clearly a false doctrine, not saying they don't believe in the rapture, they're allowed to say they don't believe in the rapture. They don't have to believe in that. They can, you can agree to disagree on those things. False doctrine is them telling you, oh, you can be saved by some other way than Jesus. You know, Jesus is not God, like the Jehovah's Witnesses, something like that. That's false doctrine. All right, brothers and sisters, God bless you guys. Let's have unity among the brethren. I think I'll make a video and just read off the name of every preacher, person I could think of, and see if I can get at least one judgmental, condemning, negative, non-Christian comment on each of the people that I mentioned. I think that's what I'll do next time.